For a little bit more on this story, we're joined by the Phones for You founder, philanthropist and Conservative donor, John Caudwell. John will be there in just a second, but hopefully I can he can still hear me. John, hopefully you can hear me. I'm just wondering what you make of the apology that we heard from the Prime Minister at Prime Minister's questions today.
Well, I think the difficulty is that we don't really know the full truth. We know he was there. We don't know the full truth of whether he really thought he was going to a party. Either way, it's very damning for him because he should know. You know, if there's a part, if there's 100 people in his back garden, he should really know what they're doing. And the bigger question also is, what are 100 people, senior Tories, as I understand it, senior politicians, doing? Obviously breaking the law in some cases. Some may not have been. Some may have thought they were going to a business meeting. I don't know, but the bring your own booze and cheese sounds dreadful. I think, though, we do have to give the Prime Minister the benefit of the doubt until the end of this inquiry. And I think if this inquiry goes badly against him, he then probably is in a totally untenable situation. I don't welcome that, but I welcome the right result, but I don't welcome that. We've got so many challenges in this country to face, post-Brexit challenges and challenges to post-pandemic challenges, to get the country booming again and get make people's livelihoods attractive, to reduce inflation and to do all the things we need to do. We don't need to be spending time on issues like this, but we have no option because they've been created by a Conservative government that has done, at the very best, stupid things, and at the worst, grossly arrogant and irresponsible rule-breaking things.
Well, just on that point then, John, why necessarily the need to wait for Sue Gray to conclude that inquiry? If, as you suggest, the spectrum on which his actions falls between, you know, stupid at one hand and, you know, possibly illegal on the other. I mean, it, just in terms of the court of public opinion, you dip your toe into social water. People seem pretty clear as to what constitutes a party, even if the Prime Minister is not, and even if Sue Gray ultimately decides that it was technically within the rules.
Yeah, let me just be clear on that then. I didn't say that the Prime Minister obviously knew it was a party. I don't know that, and that's why we need to wait for the inquiry. But what I'm certain of is that amongst 100 of those people that had been invited to bring cheese and wine, there must have been. They were either very, very stupid or they... I just can't believe that they didn't think that there might be some rule-breaking in that action. And so... there is some stupidity, but maybe even, well, definitely some rule-breaking and going against the rules when the whole country was locked down. So the one thing I've got no doubt of whatsoever is there are guilty people amongst that 100 who should be dismissed from office. Whether the Prime Minister is one of those remains to be seen as a conclusion of the inquiry.
A man who's been as successful as you, John, understands the benefits of having advisors close to you that can turn around and say, do you know what, John, maybe this isn't the time to do this, or perhaps we should think again on this, John. Does Boris Johnson have anyone capable of doing that with him right now?
Well, I will tell you something, and that is that I offered to be Boris's advisor and Rishi Sunak's advisor on multiple occasions, and they never took me up on it. And I can tell you without doubt, had Boris done that, there is no way he would be in this mess now, or he'd have just sacked me and sent me on the way home, because I would not have stood for a fraction of what's gone on. And I don't just understand how a party for 100 people can go on in your back garden and you not know about it. I hope he didn't, because I don't want to swap the Prime Minister out. We've got too many challenges, but it would not have happened under my watch.
Where then does the pressure most come from in your mind? Is it from, you know, kind of donors to the party? Is it from the kind of the grandees within the cabinet? Is it from the backbenches? Or is it just from the normal man, the punter, the man in the Clapham omnibus who looks at the sacrifices he made over the past couple of years and the parties?
Yeah, well, I think, first of all, the donors don't have anywhere near the power that people seem to think they have. You know, I've only spoken to Boris once or twice in 2 years, and Rishi once. We don't have the power. I mean, maybe the one or two donors do. I don't know, but I certainly don't. But I think if the Tory electorate turn against Boris, as they have done, and MPs feel and cabinet ministers feel that they're going to lose their positions in the next election as a result of Boris remaining in position, that is what will absolutely make his position untenable.
John, I'm so sorry, but we are literally just at that point out of time this hour, but I'm glad we got to spend as much time with you as we did. John Caldwell, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure. Thank you.